Hey there. In my past two videos on Alien Orifice and Montana, I covered a specific part of Frank Zappa's compositional style, which could largely be described as modal. This is because of techniques like modulating by specific root movement, where the harmony and a mode like Lydian or Dorian are linked together. But of course, there's an entire universe of different pieces he presented, like the wild interlude of Jumbo Go Away, which is largely chromatic. It's pretty systemic in that there are parameters that Zappa sets up and follows throughout. Techniques like isomelism, harmonic planing, and how he uses white keys against black keys. I'm also very excited to be joined throughout this video by Brett Clement, Associate Professor of Music at Ball State University, and to my mind, the greatest scholar on Frank Zappa's music on the planet. Brett has made some pretty revolutionary discoveries on this piece and Zappa in general that we'll get to, but first we should talk about the tune, and the album it appears on, as a whole. Released in September of 1981, Zappa's criminally underrated You Are What You Is is a double album filled with brilliantly crafted songs that of course feature his famous piercing social commentary. With only one fully instrumental track on the entire album, all the vocal tunes make the turbulent interlude we're going to dissect all the more impactful. Recorded in the summer of 1980, it features his band fresh off a 5-month tour. Ray White and Ike Willis handling vocal and rhythm guitar duties, Tommy Mars on keyboards, Arthur Barrow on bass, and New Edition drummer David Logeman, who was replacing Vinnie Colaiuta. There is some live material on this tour that was used as basic tracks, but the majority of it was the first Zappa album ever recorded at the Utility Muffin Research Kitchen, his new home studio. It also featured tons and tons of overdubs, some of them recorded by Steve Vai, who had joined the band in the fall of 1980. Now, the album is essentially built as three suites, and they're big blocks of material that were mostly recorded in a single take without stopping. Near the end of the last group is where we find our tune. Now, what does that title, Jumbo Go Away, mean? Well, on the first performance of this tune, Frank explains it to the audience.
Once upon a time, we were in a place in the middle of the United States called Kalamazoo, Michigan. Perhaps not the most attractive town in the So we're in Kalamazoo, Michigan. There's these girls that stop by to visit some members of the band. One of them had a head about the size of a buffalo. Figuratively speaking, and in actuality, she attached herself to a member of our group. Gave him a really bad time for all several days, until in distress, he was seen wandering the halls of the hotel, mumbling to himself, and he was saying, Jumbo go away.
Now that said band member has come forward, I think it's okay to name guitarist Denny Wally as the inspiration for the tune. But this isn't important. What we're interested in is that for a song that mostly sounds like this, there's an interlude that sounds like this. It's actually a huge compositional device for Zappa. The idea is that he takes a pretty standard song, usually with an easy to follow form, and inserts an intense instrumental section that's usually classically influenced.
So there's kind of an interesting sub area within Zappa is that there are these pieces that are usually one of his sillier songs, you know, with lyrics, and then he'll insert these very short instrumentals into it. And I think this is a really fascinating aspect of Zappa's output that I wish he did more of it. It's actually something he does a little more in his early era. Well, of course, Brown Shoes Don't Make It is a good example of that, where he inserts a short little 12-tone piece in there. He also did that a little bit on the Uncle Meat album, like with the song Dog Breath and The Year of a Plague. Tends to be these like atonal pieces, similar to what we're gonna talk about today. And I always thought that was a great way to introduce this music, as opposed to the long pieces. The long pieces are pretty challenging for the listener, but when you put something that's really dense like this in a more accessible short piece, you get a really interesting effect, and it's much easier to digest for the listener. It's also just a little bit of taking the piss out of the seriousness of, you know, classical composition to put a piece like this that's, usually associated with very serious atonal composers and put it in a song called Jumbo Go Away, or in the song Wet T-Shirt Night. It just sort of, it just shows that Zappa's not taking himself too seriously, essentially.
And speaking of which, the middle section of Fembot in a Wet T-Shirt was written separately and put into the song, just like Jumbo Go Away. Bassist during this period, Arthur Barrow, explains Zappa's process of inserting instrumental interludes. An interesting thing Frank was doing at the time was writing what he called insertion units. He brought in charts for us with numbers for titles, like number 2 or number 6. These instrumentals were usually fairly short, only a minute or two in length. He had us work them up as a regular part of rehearsal, but they were not part of the planned show. He said he would find places to use them in future songs, and that is what he did. Number 6, for example, became the instrumental middle section of Jumbo Go Away. Another was the middle part of Wet T-Shirt Night. This was an approach to composing I did not expect, but I thought it was quite clever. In my Alien Orifice video, I discussed insertion unit number 2, which I transcribed and found out was a precursor to both Drowning Witch and Alien Orifice. It's obvious how important these are, so let's hear number 6 in Jumbo Go Away. The tune went through differences in arrangement due to changing band members, but I really like how it ended up on the record with Steve Vai high in the mix on his parts. It already sounds like this demented fife and drum music because of the way Logeman catches the melody on the snare drum, but add in the guitar and it becomes this satanic 80s hair metal march. It's awesome. There are tons of elements to cover here. The single line itself, the harmony from the chord tracking element that we'll get to, how the electrocomp and bass notes interact, and of course, odd time signatures. It makes sense to start at its simplest form and work our way up. Now just based on how this sounds, we can tell it's atonal and very chromatic. It almost sounds like the modern serialist composers, and well, it's actually not that far off in a way. Was Zappa actually influenced by the second Viennese school though? No, not that one. Aha, we have a winner, Anton Webern. We mentioned before the little piece that appears in Brown Shoes Don't Make It, but is Jumbo Go Away also 12-tone? No, we don't really see a standard row that goes through retrograde, inversion, and retrograde inversion. But there are non-12-tone serialism techniques. Is Zappa using one of those? Well, the answer is in fact, yes. There is a sort of row that serves as the foundation of the interlude, and is repeated throughout using isomelic variations. Now, you might have heard the word isomelism in relation to Zappa's music before, but what exactly is that?
Isomelism is kind of along the same lines of a classical term that we call isorhythm. The simplest way to state this is that it's basically stating the exact same series of pitches and just changing the rhythms. That's as simple as it is, just the same pitches but using different rhythms. It's basically a variation technique. The famous example, first example, that was first noticed by the scholar Jonathan Bernard is from the song Oh No. So you get this theme right here. And it's actually 28 pitches, the whole theme. So a very long sequence of pitches with a distinctive rhythm as well. And then here you get, this is the isomelic restatement of it right here. And Notice it has the exact same pitches, but the rhythms are changed. The thing that's interesting about the way Zappa uses this, I think, he changes the rhythms to such an extent that most listeners probably don't even realize that they're hearing the same thing a second time. We know from perceptual studies that listeners are only able to kind of remember about 7 bits of information at a time. So maybe listeners will be able to notice that these 7 pitches are the same as these 7, but after that, I think it's pretty much a free-for-all, and it'd be unlikely that most listeners would realize that this second phrase uses the exact same pitches as this one. So this would be a basic and kind of a telling example of isomelism in Zappa's music.
I cover the topic in my Alien Orifice breakdown as well, a piece in which Brett noticed another great example of this technique. These can range from relatively easier to spot ones like Inca Roads, to challenging ones in orchestral works like in Moe and Herb's Vacation. The point is, it's all over the music, but how does it work in Jumbo Go Away?
You get here also a pretty long melody, 19 pitches. This is first, I guess, played mostly by the guitar and also some keyboards. Just this crazy sounding atonal melody. Then you immediately get it back right here. Again, this is played so fast, so actually noticing that this and this are the same melody, though as you'll see, it's transposed down by half step. So that is another technique that Zappa uses. I guess this will be even more like a serialist technique to transpose it. That's one of the kind of standard serial music techniques of transposition. Then finally, we get it in the most disguised form at all, played extremely fast in 16th notes by the keyboards. And so there are 3 major statements.
That brings a question to my mind, though. Is it possible that Zappa actually started with the 3rd isomelic variation, or the one with the least varied rhythm, and worked his way back, expanding the rhythms as he went on? We know, for example, that in Inca Roads, the 2nd isomelic variation, the one with the least varied rhythm again, was actually the first one composed. The 1st isomelic variation was the 2nd one composed, although they appear in reverse order in the piece, essentially tricking the listener.
Yeah, maybe Zappa just started off, since that's just straightforward 16th notes, maybe he just started off with a very basic, you know, pitch sequence, and then it comes, really, the issue of composition becomes a rhythm issue, where you're just sort of changing the rhythms, and it's just amazing how good Zappa is at creating these very distinctive rhythms that are so different from each other that the listener doesn't even notice that they're being presented with different, the same melody twice.
So it makes sense why we brought up that serial influence on Zappa. His method of isomelism and using a series of pitches to develop material has to come from that, right?
Probably, if you're thinking about isomelism in Zappa and you're wondering where he got this idea, it's probably from his big influences in the post-tonal realm of Webern and Berez. Well, I think we're going to see a lot of stuff in this music that kind of shows those are his 2 biggest influences for his more atonal kind of stuff. Oh No used a diatonic scale, which is actually kind of unique to use that in a serial way. I mean, using it as a series of pitches. Whereas Jumbo Go Away, you're going to get more of an atonal melody, and you're going to get more of that style. And as always, Zappa just finds a really interesting way to kind of take this to a new extreme, both in terms of the kind of pitch structure he's using, but also just in the way it's presented.
I also had to ask, because it's such a cool discovery by Brett that most of this melody is built off 1 series of pitches and different rhythms, how surprising was it when you found out?
What I was surprised by is just by how often I found it in his music and how many different ways it would be used. Sometimes it's just like a disguised repetition. So very basic surface level technique, way of generating new melody. And other times it's like a big formal technique. It's like a large scale isomelic variation, or it's like kind of the way he goes about doing reorganizing of the music, like Inca Roads. I think Inca Roads is a great example of that. Like you mentioned, the original melody is just sort of like straight 8th notes, and then he wrote another melody that would be in a different part of the song. It's a way of creating form.
Well, now we've at least established that we're working with a single melodic line for essentially the majority of this interlude, which makes it way less daunting already. So the next step is to actually dig into the line. What's happening here? It starts with 3 30-second notes. D, A sharp, F sharp. This spells out a D augmented triad, which is funny because the last chord of the bridge before the interlude is actually D. Melodically, it resolves to G, which was the key center of the last four bars of the bridge after a half step key change from F sharp. I don't know if that's a major coincidence or if he planned it, but that's pretty cool. This three-note motif will show up plenty of times, but before we even go deeper, I have to let you in on the secret. There is an actual pattern here that reveals its underlying compositional origin, and it goes beyond any intervallic connection. It's even easier to spot if we separate the synth key and electrocomp parts, as Zappa did in the score. Just at first glance, you probably notice the numerical pattern. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, so on and so forth, until the one note then three pattern here. It's even deeper than that, though. Notice that all the notes on the electrocomp are all naturals. No sharps and no flats. D, F, D, G, D, G. All the two-note patterns on the synth key have accidentals, and it's all sharps. A sharp, F sharp, G sharp, D sharp, F sharp, C sharp, so on. Well, you could almost think of it like the piano. The white keys, or the naturals, against the black keys, the accidentals. Zappa was no stranger to writing with an instrument in mind and using its strength. There's a billion examples of sections of his music that came about because of the guitar, regardless of how it lays on other instruments. But is there any evidence that Jumbo Go Away originates from Zappa's piano playing? Would I even ask if the answer was no? Tommy Mars recounts the time Zappa first brought the interlude into rehearsal.
We had these things called number 7, number 9, number 6, number 4, and they were inserts. But there's one for Jumbo that starts with and then there's a part that goes. Anyway, Frank brings it in, and I'm looking at it, and I'm like blinking my eyes. I'm saying, it's all in the treble clef. And when you're a pianist and you see treble clef, you immediately think, organically, right hand. And I'm kind of negotiating it, but it's like the first time he's ever written anything up to that point that I'm saying to myself, uh-oh. I don't know if I can really play this. And Frank's looking at me and saying, "Wow, a little difficult, huh, Mars?" And I'm looking at it and I'm trying to play it, and my left hand's on my lap, you know? I'm playing it and it's like unbelievably difficult for one hand. It's unbelievably difficult. He's seeing me struggle. He's seeing me die. And he's starting to laugh. He says, want me to play it for you? I said, quit it, Frank. I'm trying to get this, man. And he said, Tommy, I could show you how to play it. Frank, please. I'm trying to get this. It's not funny, man, all right? You know, I'm really trying to get this. Then he's starting to laugh. And he said, Mars, would you push over on the bench and let me play this damn thing? And he goes over and he puts one hand on top of the other. And it's with the black keys and the white keys, that kind of technique. But I had never touched my left hand. I was only trying to play it with my right. And he comes in and he says, check this out. With two hands, I dropped to my knees. I was screaming laughing. That was the heaviest time he ever got me on anything like that. But he actually played it, you know? I mean, it's a childlike technique. You just play your black keys with your right hand and your white keys with your left.
I love that story. It's really coming from a technique standpoint, much more than Zappa sitting down and figuring out this wild melody purely intervallically or just on his ear. And it makes sense that he'd use this childlike technique. He referred to himself as a plunker on the piano, and he considers it an elaborate percussion instrument, so you can see what it looks like. Left hand stays on the white keys and the right on the black. The left is usually in the same position, and the right moves around it. This is a technique we'd call cross hand. And it's not exactly new. I remember one of my music history teachers showing me this Bach piece, and I almost fell out of my chair. Exactly like Jumbo, you can see that one hand stays constant while the other moves freely around it. The only difference is that it's opposite hands. In Jumbo, the left hand stays constant while the right moves. And in the Bach partita, the right stays constant while the left moves. I really love compositional devices like this that can surprise you and bring out creativity. Another one not exactly along those lines but still interesting is Joe Zawinul inverting his synthesizer on the Weather Report tune Black Market so that going down on the keys actually goes up in pitch and vice versa. But back to Jumbo, there's a pattern here.
Essentially what we have here is the alternation between the note D and G, and then you have two black keys in between. So D, G, two black keys in between, D, G, two black keys in between, all the way down the line. And then in between it, you get these, like I said, black keys on the keyboard, and essentially what these are they're what we call pentatonic thirds. So in the pentatonic scale, which would be the same as the black keys on the keyboard, if you move down in thirds, you'll get some things that would traditionally would look like perfect fourths. This is an ordinary third, but this is also a third within the pentatonic scale. And you'll notice it's just kind of going down in the scale through the black keys on the keyboard. A sharp, F sharp, G sharp, D sharp, F sharp, C sharp, and so on and so forth. It's just sort of moving down in parallel motion.
Another tune that utilizes pentatonic thirds on the black keys is King Kong. The key is E flat minor, so it fits perfectly. Zappa has, in fact, mentioned that King Kong was a piano exercise, and now it's all starting to make more sense.
I think also, by the way, and it's harder to tell, I think he was also influenced by some of the American ultra-modern composers. And something that all these composers have in common is they're very interested in exhausting all 12 notes of the octave, the pitch class aggregate. And so you find that also in Zappa's melodies is this kind of interest in getting all 12 notes pretty fast, and you kind of then you start over. It's not done in a very systematic way. Rez is kind of involved in those too. Rez, William Schumann, and a lot of these other composers that are part of the ultra-modern musical style, essentially, will do this, kind of things like this. And I think you find this in, of course, the black key versus white key thing going on in Jumbo Go Away. That's because, you know, black key, if you add all the white keys and all the black keys together, you, of course, will get all 12 notes.
By mixing up the white keys and black ones, he goes for aggregate completion, getting all 12 notes of the octave. There's only one small problem. Zappa actually changes notes and doesn't get all 12 pitches, making it not perfectly symmetrical.
Something that Zappa does in general that I've noticed is just, and of course, there's no way to, since I don't have Zappa's scores, original notation, I can't be certain about this, is that you'll look at the structure of the melody and there will be this strong suggestion that the music is kind of constructed in a very intellectual way, that if, for example, it might be a transposition, there might be symmetry, another thing, there might be a sense that the two halves of the melody are mirror images of each other, and that's one thing I think we do find a little bit with this particular example. But he'll throw it off. He'll have this perfect symmetry, but then when he notates it, I don't think it's a mistake, by the way, I really think that he will intentionally change some notes. And I don't think he's doing that because he wants to disguise it necessarily, though that could be one issue. He may just wants to disguise. He doesn't want to do things too straightforward. I think it's because he'll play back what he came up with, and he just won't like a note or two. He'll say, well, gee, that note sounds better if I just change it to this note here.
If you take a look at the basic series of pitches, you'll see the first 9 pitches are actually retrograde inversion to the last 9 pitches, a pretty perfect symmetry. But for reasons we can only speculate, Zappa changes this F sharp to an F natural and this D to a D flat, destroying that symmetrical relationship.
And I think that's an example of Zappa just kind of playing through it and not being really happy with the result. It seems a little odd that you'd throw off this perfect kind of structure that's so easy to see. Partly that could be just to disguise his technique, but another thing would just be he didn't like the way it sounded. Especially if you played it the original way, you'll find it just sounds better what Zappa did. I think Zappa just found the F sharp kind of boring sounding. That F natural just stands out in an interesting way. So, I mean, it's almost like there's nothing sacred. There's no, he's really interested in these highly intellectual ways of creating musical material, like creating notes, but he also doesn't hold it sacred where you can't just change it. If it doesn't sound good, then he'll just change the note. So it's kind of like, you know, highly intellectualized and also highly intuitive, whether he likes it or not, essentially.
So the ears have the final say, which makes sense. But wouldn't it be neat if there were other examples of Zappa using aggregate completion and playing with white keys against black keys? Well, there is. And you've probably never even heard it before.
So here's another piece that I actually think is probably was being written around the same time as the Jumbo Go Away interlude. This is just a short 3-measure excerpt from the orchestral Sinister Footwear. So you can actually only find this on the orchestral version. This measure is so obviously similar to the Jumbo Go Away melody. Starts with the same few notes, right? A sharp and F sharp and then a D. Notice, hey, 2 black keys, D, 2 black keys, G, and so on. Just a single melody. It looks so much like Jumbo Go Away, and we already mentioned that that's kind of a white key versus black key alternation, but then look what happens on the outside. You get just a scale going through the white keys on the keyboard. And so even though Jumbo Go Away does not actually give you all 12 pitches, this one does. And so I think this is a spot, you know, here you get, this is all the pitch classes. 0 is C, by the way, B is 11, C sharp is 1. You get all 12 of these pitch classes, and then, you know, by this note here, you've got the full completion of the aggregate. And to me, this is just a little bit of evidence that there is this kind of idea of exhausting the aggregate in the jumbo go away interlude. As I mentioned, a lot of times Zappa will alter things he'll have like a perfect symmetrical structure and he'll alter a note here and there. And I mentioned earlier how some notes get altered in the melody. Well, they also tend to throw off the symmetry a little bit. If this note had been D and you go from the outside in, it's almost a mirror symmetry of itself. So this goes up 8 half steps, going from the backwards. If this had been a D natural, that would have gone down 8 half steps. Reversing their direction and using the same interval in a backwards direction. That's what we call RI symmetry or retrograde inversion symmetry. Anyhow, it's flawed in this example because of those changes of pitches and also the G throws it off. So, it's not a great example of a straightforward symmetry, but it's very interesting. When you look here, there's a lot of symmetry going on in this particular example. One type of symmetry is this kind of single measure in the middle that's different, and the two outer measures that are kind of similar. Notice how you have this rising line here in the white keys and the descending line. And then you get this sort of like an ABA construction of the melody. So it's very symmetrical. And then another thing that's symmetrical about this is the bass line. The contour of this particular bass line, is basically the same backwards here. The C seg tells you which note is the lowest note, which will be called zero, and which note is the highest note, which here is seven, because zero will be the lowest note and seven will be the highest note. Well, depending on how many pitches you had, but here there are seven distinct pitches. C is the lowest note, so it's called zero. Then this G is called three because it's the third lowest note, and so on and so forth. Then notice that this bass line here has the exact opposite numbers. It has 7, 4, 6, 2, 5, 1, 3, 0, whereas this had the other direction, 0, 3, 1, 5, 2, 6, 4, 7. So they're basically retrograde inversions of each other. There's a lot of symmetry going on here, and to me that just strengthens my analysis of the jumbo melody as being having some sort of symmetrical thing implied by it, even though it's really hard to find in the actual jumbo example.
Wow, I feel like we've really unlocked a lot about this interlude and Zappa's thinking. By the way, if you didn't notice it yet, this first bar of the Sinister Footwear example also appears in Inca Roads. Alright, well, we can go back through this line. We've covered these measures, isomelic variations 1 and 2. Now on measure 8, we get three measures of something distinctly pianistic, sort of the I have worms break in this interlude, if you will. By the way, there's a metric modulation here. It goes double time, or something like quarter note equals eighth note now. Metric modulations don't always involve a change in meter, so the term can be confusing. All it means is that there's a change in tempo where the music is based on a previous note value. Double time and half time are the most commonly used ones. Anyways, it's double time here in another white key versus black key movement. The left hand stays constant, E to G. The right hand pattern starts on G sharp, D sharp, up to A sharp, F sharp, back down to G sharp, D sharp, and down to F sharp, C sharp, where the pattern starts over again after that. Notice the last time it happens, there's a nice transition, F sharp, C sharp to C in the next bar. Another metric modulation gets us back to the original tempo, and we see the transposition of the original five notes, this time starting on C. Then the next bar is the same, but up a half step, exactly as we see it in bar 4. And now we're back into more white key, black key madness, this time with another metric modulation. Starting in the 6-16 bar, a quarter note from the previous bar is now equal to a dotted quarter note. This means these 6 sixteenths would be the rhythmic value equivalent of 16th note sextuplets in the previous tempo. I think these modulations were added sometime in rehearsal as they're not indicated in the score. So this is the third isomelic variation, as you know, cleverly fit into two bars of 6-16 and 7-16 to get all 19 pitches as 16th notes. And the next four bars are familiar as well, the E to G in the white keys, while the black keys play the same pattern as we saw eight bars earlier. Just to put this in perspective, we've made it this far into the interlude, and we've only gotten essentially two different series of pitches. That shows you just how much Zappa reuses material and how he loves variation. So after four bars, Zappa's gonna take this little motif of E down to G and just move it down the white keys. D F for two bars, C E for two bars, B BD for two bars until it turns into AE. The black keys start on D sharp, A sharp, and continue to move down in the same pattern until this C sharp, where it moves back up again, rising up until this A sharp, F sharp. It creates this nice motion where the left hand moves down and the right moves down back up again. Just like how the left hand breaks the pattern when it goes to AE, the right hand does the same by repeating G-sharp, D-sharp, and F-sharp, C-sharp twice. It's funny, this is almost like a true polytonal concept, two contrasting key centers in each hand. It's really apparent if you separate each one. The white keys sound very inside, and the black keys sound very inside, and it's just so neat that you can take two inside sounds that share no notes and create this madness. Anyways, the bar before the odd time bars come in, the pattern is broken in a major way. Two black keys start the bar with F sharp, A sharp, then G in the left hand before another switch. This time the right hand quickly switches to the white keys, and the left hand to black. AF in the right, and C sharp in the left. It's quick, but again, Zappa loves to establish patterns, and once you're just getting used to it, he has to throw you a curveball. Notice too, the little augmented triad that opens the interlude exists here as A, F, C sharp. Actually, we see it before this too in the 16th note sections, and here. And now the last four bars are odd time, a bar of 5-16, a bar of 7-16, and then those same bars again. In this first bar, it switches left and right hand every other note. First E, then this open stack of fifths, G sharp, D sharp, A sharp, then C in the left, C sharp and F sharp in the right, and D in the left. If you watched my other videos, you know open fifths and fourths are such an important sound in Zappa's music. It happens so fast that I think the keyboardists play the top note every time. Same with these fourths. The bar of 7 has a different pattern. Two black keys, every other three times, and then two black keys again. The pentatonic thirds move downwards, G sharp, D sharp, F sharp, C sharp, separated by a white key, and then A sharp, F sharp, and E sharp, which I suppose is technically a white key. The left hand is doing major six again, but one we haven't seen yet, A to C. The next bar of 5 is pretty simple because it starts with two notes, D sharp, a minor ninth down to D. We talked about the importance of wide intervals to his sound as well, especially with how much it shows up in the sister interlude of Fembot. After it comes back up to this D sharp and repeats, the first repeated note, at least within the same bar, that we see in this entire interlude, you don't have to usually wait until the end of a section of music to find that in Zappa's compositions. Still, I think it's necessary and exists to break the pattern with some good repetition, along with using one of Zappa's favorite intervals, the minor ninth, before that D moves up another white key to E. Remember the idea of chromatic cells with octave displacement? Well, here's a good pattern. The cell is D, D sharp, E, with D sharp and D reversed, and D sharp displaced. Finally, we get to the last bar of the interlude, another of 7-16. Now we get another different pattern of white and black keys. All four odd time bars have different patterns here. This last one is white key, three black keys, one white key again, and then two black keys. A, C sharp, G sharp, D sharp, B, A sharp, F sharp. Look at the overarching way the black keys move. A sharp, F sharp, G sharp, D sharp, F sharp, C sharp, A sharp, D sharp, C sharp, G sharp, D sharp, A sharp, F sharp. I've said sharp so much it doesn't even sound like a word anymore. So even over bar lines, you see the pentatonic third pattern continue down and up. After this bar, it returns back to the sign, the first 6-16 bar, and repeats again until it segues back into the verse, complete with another metric modulation back to the original time. So let's hear and see this full interlude one more time. And that covers this wild melodic line. So it's really two experiments going on at once. Isomelism, where Zappa uses one series of pitches to supply material for the majority of the interlude, and white keys against the black keys on the piano, where Zappa takes a childlike technique and moves it around to suit his ear. But like I said, this is only the first part of the substantial madness contained within. There's a heavy harmonic element to this. And I don't mean the kind where we see chord changes and a melody that corresponds on top of it, but you could probably already guess that. Let me explain. The interlude is scored for synth key and electrocomp, two synths that were part of the keyboard rig for Tommy Mars. The synth key, developed by Electronic Music Laboratories in 1976, was one of the first programmable polyphonic synths, meaning it could produce more than one tone at a time. Well, the synth itself was technically monophonic, but had 13 oscillators, one for the primary note and 12 for other notes of your choice. There were two models, the 1500 and 2000. Together, EML made about only 75, and Zappa owned one of each model. And he really loved the chord tracking element. In this interlude, the idea is that there's a parallel harmony getting tracked throughout. It's really similar to another EML product produced a year later, the Polybox. A 13-key little keyboard controller, it took single pitches from monophonic synthesizers and created polyphonic chord memory presets covering an octave. Both of these were used essentially as interfaces with the electrocomp to play parallel harmonies and not as standalone synths. As Tommy Mars said, you can almost count on one hand the times you use the keyboard part of it. While the Polybox already took an input signal, Zappa had the synth key modified with various outputs and switches, which enabled it to be used by the electrocomp. You can hear, and see, a really good example of Tommy Mars using this function at a 1980 concert in Paris.
Okay, this is the Polybox that tracks parallel chords.
Frank was very sick that night. And here's Pierre, like, all hot to trot, Mr. Bon Vivant. And Frank is, like, dying. He says, Tommy, go out and show him your gear. I said, Frank, this is Pierre Boulez, man. You gotta be shitting me. He says, he's just a regular dude. Just show him what the little poly box is. Show him the vocoder. I said, okay. So I walk him out. I said, well, this is called a poly box. This is an interface of the three electrocomp instruments that I'm using. And I have my instrument playing the melody note on top. Now, when I pull this fader up, this poly box comes in and it has a memory to it that will remember the chord until I change the chord. It was an actual keyboard. So it's like a polyphonic choir of a sound, and it's a pitch matcher. It'll follow the pitch of the master instrument. It's acting as a slave. So he said, you mean you can just hold down as many notes of this chord as you want? I said, yeah. And then on the top, to add the icing to the cake, the little sinking, I had a piccolo sound.
Now that chord tracking element is present in both insertion units for Jumbo and Fembot. And both of them use the same chord, just a simple major triad where the top line is the third of the chord. Here's Fembot with the tracked chord written in there, and you can see each is a major triad and second inversion. However, you don't have to actually notate the full harmony each time. Zappa explained how to notate for this, saying, you can just add a little inscription at the head of the bar, kind of like a key signature. Next you write a single line, and if the guy sets his synthesizer up right, that single line will yield parallel chords tracking around, so it saves you a lot of writing on paper. Zappa, however, did decide to write it all out in the number 6 interlude for wind quintet, as clarinet, oboe, and bassoon play each part of the triad. And those instruments haven't come around to parallel chord tracking, at least not yet. When Steve Vai was in the band, you can pretty clearly hear his part. He plays the root of the triad, which looks and sounds like this. So this entire interlude, the top melodic voice is harmonized as a major triad and second inversion. When you take a single harmony and move all voices in the same exact direction, this is parallel harmony or harmonic planing, like here. Or here. He uses the same exact voicing that we see in Jumbo and Fembot and planes it on Shove It Right In, off 200 Motels. Check it out. And of course, it doesn't have to be just triads. We can see six note chords, or seven note chords. But here we settle as a parallel tracked major triad, which sounds like this. Thank you. fun thing about this is that even if you take a simple harmony, the fact that it's moving at such a high velocity still gives you this wild sound. So we've covered the first two levels of this, and they're both coming out of simple concepts. The single line comes from left hand against right hand on the piano, and the harmony it generates from the electrocomp comes from a plain old major triad. It's so genius on his part that he takes these concepts that everyone has and uses them to create something like this that you would never expect. But that's not all yet. If you think about it, tracking a single harmony of any kind for a long time would, in theory, get monotonous. Zappa was aware of this and makes it interesting with two voices, the electrocomp and the bass line. They're unison for the first two bars and make a power chord on the third with fifths here. You can hear this part really clearly in the 79 band. Starting in the fourth bar, the second isomelic variation, you can see it's playing the single line but not quite the same as the sin key line. You can see they're a major seventh apart. That seems really strange, but don't forget we have a triad, so let's put that all together and check it out. It turns into this really gorgeous four-note voicing, and it's something that Zappa uses often. You can look at it like a triad plus a fourth. The very first one, for example, from the top down, is C-sharp, A, E, D, A major with the fourth in there. We see stuff like this in Alien Orifice and Montana, but those are in arpeggiated form. As a single harmony, we see it all over, like in Zoo to Lores, Sinister Footwear, or the Mammy Anthem. And even the most casual Zappa fan could recognize this sound. I think this voicing is so beautiful, but we're not even done yet. We have the complete top voicing, but it's missing the bottom. Now let's add the bass part and listen to how deep this harmony gets. So let's check these out now. Just for the first isomelic variation before the second voice comes in, here are the harmonies that we see. There are some really interesting voicings that stick out over this E pedal, and taking any harmony and adding or changing the bass note can make it sound dramatically different, the idea of which this interlude is built off of. That gives us these things called slash chords. On the left is what the regular chord would be, and the right is the bass note. These are used a lot of times for inversions, like C over E, or E flat minor over B flat, but the bass note doesn't always have to be related to the chord. You can add so many interesting colors by using this technique. Another thing like this is polychords, which we would write on top of each other instead of side to side. A polychord is the combination of two chords played simultaneously, and we'll see those as well. So the whole idea is that we keep building. It's a three-note group with the triad, then a four-note group when the second voice comes in, and then the fun is where Zappa places the bass note to get different harmonic results within these. And here's what we see. B-flat over E three times, F-sharp over E three times, D over E twice, E-flat over E three times, straight up E twice, B over E twice, and A over E three times. The triad with a tritone in the bass is a particularly pointed and tense sort of sound. Like a lot of these, we see it tons in the Fembot interlude as well. Slash chords separated by a whole step, like F-sharp with E in the bass, is a classic sort of Zappa sound, and the Lydian implications are obvious. Something like Andy comes to mind. Slash chords separated by flat 7, like D over E, is a heavily used sus sound that can resolve back to 1 or 4, like in Dancing Fool, for example. Or it can stay there and be used in a modal context, like in Yo Mama. You ain't really made Slash chords separated by fifth, like B with E in the bass, is another classic Zappa sound, like we talked about. A with E in the bass is still just A, but E flat over E is my favorite one here, and clearly a favorite of Zappa's as well. Talk about a biting kind of sound. So from the root we call these chords diminished major 7. It's spelled as 1, flat 3, flat 5, and major 7. And as far as its function, well, there's actually a lot, and not just a main one to pinpoint. It shows up a lot in jazz as a substitute for 1, that usually resolves. It also works nicely as a rootless voicing for any dominant chord that has a flat 9 but natural 13, which you could voice from the 3rd, 5th, 7th, or flat 9, or going up in minor 3rds, since it's diminished, like in I'm a Beautiful Guy. And speaking of minor 3rds, Zappa then takes this voicing down in minor 3rds for this Coltrane-esque F-sharp half-hole diminished lick. That's one of the more ambiguous functions, but what about times where we can say, yes, that is a straight up diminished major 7th chord or a slash chord triad with the flat 2 in the bass, or whatever you want to call it. Well, we don't even have to change songs yet, like here. But you pretend to be shy. Or here. So I want to know why. You make me cry. And in truly clever fashion, Zappa brings back the same harmony in Beauty Knows No Pain here. Man, how great is that? I love how connected these tunes are. Even another rhyme between shy, why, cry, try, and finally in the next song, lie. And there are others, like Zoodalores, where you can see how easy the shape is on guitar. Or how about near the end of Cucamonga? Or in Markson's Chicken? Or the bridge of Teenage Prostitute. It's all over the blue light. Your ethos, your pathos, your portos, your elements, your beast alone. You're riding home. You are hopeless, rising. Or for comical effect, to mess with the cliche blues endings in Bamboozled by Love or In France. Never try to get your Beatles out in France. Danger, Will Robinson, danger! But the real showpiece here for this harmony is what Zappa described as the country song on PCP, Truck Driver Divorce. The bold and intelligent masters of the road with their secret language. And their tyrannical transcontinental hobby rules. Truck Driver Divorce. Oh, the wife, oh, the kids, oh, the waitress, oh, the drive all night. Sometimes when you come home, her ass, do deliver some string beans. Deliver some string beans. Deliver all the string beans to your dog. Sorry I went off on a bit of an example tangent there, but it shows up a lot in Jumbo, and I really think it's worth talking about. It's a specific voicing that Zappa uses often and well. So the second isomelic variation naturally becomes a lot more interesting with the added voice. With five notes instead of four, how is it different though? Well, that added electrocomp note, a major seventh below the melody, usually acts as a third of the bass note here. The top four notes are always going to be the same, we know that, but the bass note is flexible enough for Zappa to have fun with it. This four note group going down as F sharp, D, A, G, or D major with G, gets an E flat in the bass. Now see that E flat and G is a major third, and we still have D major, so it's a true D major over E flat major. We see this exact voicing in Sinister Footwear. And here are some more polychords, which are separated by whole step instead of half step now. You can see the fifth between the bass note and the electrocomp note. No third there, but I think that's strong enough to get the full picture. The rest are slash chords, and really nice ones at that. By placing the bass note a ninth away, you get this harmony here, minor 11th. We see G minor 11 here, and again down an octave here. Now, what if you place the bass note a minor 6th away? Pretty mysterious sounding. But place that bass note up an octave, and it's really easy to see. It's actually a minor major 7 chord. You know, like James Bond? The bass note is not the root, but it's the minor 3rd instead. We see this harmony as F sharp minor major 7 three times, the last time down an octave. We also see it up a half step here as G minor major 7, and then the last note of the second isomelic variation, C sharp minor major 7. And the last harmony is when he places the bass note a fifth away. You get this really pretty voicing. Just like the last voicing, I think it's another where the third is in the bass, this time as a major seventh chord. We see it three times. E flat major 7 with G in the bass, G major 7 with B in the bass, and D major 7 with F sharp in the bass. Now let's go back and hear this section again, knowing what these rich harmonies are. Now we get to this worm section, which doesn't have the tracking element anymore, as it's written unison. Zappa uses the directions unison and triads for when he wants the chord tracking on or off. My copy of this chart is pretty faded, so I had a hard time reading what it said, and I spent an embarrassing amount of time trying to find what the musical term trials meant and why Zappa was using it here. Anyways, we've talked about this line, but not the bass and not the counter melody on the electrocomp here. So what this counter melody does, besides sounding like some sort of demented Irish jig, is actually harmonize the top line. That's what I think this is, rather than something he generated independently. And the reason is, I think this harmonization is too man-made to be a coincidence. In the first bar, the way it lines up is all major sevenths, and we know that's been a huge theme so far. Bar 2 sees augmented seconds, which sound like minor thirds, before it's back to major sevenths on beat 3, and then tritones on beat 4. Beat 1 of the third bar is major sevenths again, minor thirds for beat 2, major sevenths for beat 3, and back to augmented seconds for beat 4. Like I said, I think this isn't a coincidence, so he was going through and picking intervals for specific parts, and the result is he ended up with this line, which makes sense that he picked a minor ninth for the bass part, C to D flat, and then the full result again sounds like this. You can clearly hear this part played by Peter Wolf on electrocomp and Ed Mann on marimba in the 79 band. And just solely by Ed Mann in the 81 band. We hit this little fake out isomelic variation, and it's back to triads from the sin key instead of unison. So the same voicings we saw earlier, a tritone apart, which gives you this Lydian sort of A flat over G flat here, and C sharp over B here. Placing the bass note a ninth apart gets you this minor 11th chord with F sharp minor 11, D minor 11 here, and E minor 11 here. Again, this voicing is one that I've seen Zappa write out exactly, like in the bridge of Sinister Footwear. So the second fake isomelic variation that moves up a half step now has something completely different. The electrocomp voice, which is usually placed a major seventh below the top note, is now spelled as an augmented ninth. That may seem foreign at first, but for all intents and purposes, it sounds the same as a minor third, just up the octave. Now, if we play just the voicing without the bass, you can see it looks pretty familiar. We get all slash chords separated by half step, or these diminished major sevens. How do Zappa's bass notes affect this, though? Well, earlier in the interlude, we saw this polychord, where the bass note and the electrocomp came together to form a major third, to give us two distinct harmonies. And we also saw another where those voicings formed a fifth. Here I think it's the exact same thing, although inverted. In the first harmony, F is the bass note, which is the fifth of the electrocomp note, B flat. Look what happens when we switch the electrocomp and bass voices. Then this first chord is built B flat, F, E, A, C sharp. I think it's the same construction as the other major chords on top of fifths. I know, you sort of have to fill in the blank a bit, but I really think this makes sense as the way to look at it, especially considering the prior constructions we see here. I don't think it's too presumptuous to say it's an A over B flat polychord or D flat over D here. That leaves us with these three other harmonies. Now on the two that we've identified, the electrocomp and bass notes were fourths because they were fifths inverted. But here we can see that they're all fifths between them, so it's likely that the bass note is also the root this time. Well, in this bar we see from the bottom up, B, F sharp, C, F, A. To me that's pretty clearly an F over B, without the third. And we've seen slash chords separated by tritone already too. It was even the very first one. Now we can identify these as F over B, D over G sharp, and up a half step as E flat over A. I love the contrary motion between the bass and syn-key line over these harmonies here. But that brings us to isomelic variation number 3. The first time is played unison, no chord tracking. And the second time is played with the triads, making this even wilder. Good news is that we can see the bass note is the same as the isomelic variation number 1. And since we know the top line is the same notes, we've already analyzed this, just with different rhythms. Only difference is this very last 16th of the bar of 7, still an A triad with the bass note of F sharp instead of G as we saw previously. This gives us an F sharp minor 7. The bass line for the rest of this interlude operates no differently. It's still tied directly to the single line and chosen to get specific harmonies in mind. Those harmonies, by the way, only appear on beats 2, 3, 5, and 6. That means we're back to just triads. I also really recommend checking out Prophetic Attitude by the French wind quintet, Le Concert Impromptu, where they play the insert number 6. You can hear the richness of the harmonies very clearly. Now obviously with this many notes, you're gonna get a lot of colors. I'll save us the time of going through all of them, and let you know that the harmony he uses the most in this section is, big surprise, we see it 9 times in total. Next is the triad and bass note by whole step 8 times, and the slash chord separated by tritone, 5th and octave, 7 times. 6 times he uses them separated by minor and major 3rd, which either gives you a minor 7th chord, or a major 7 sharp 5 chord. Then we see by 4th 5 times, which is just a major triad now with the 5th in the bass, separated by half step or flat 7 4 times, which is like a major 7th with the 7th in the bass, or a sus harmony. And finally, just 2 times each, we see separated by flat 6 or major 6, which is like a major triad with the 3rd in the bass, or a major triad with the sharp 9 in the bass. For 6 bars, he just brings this bass line down chromatically, before making the more intentional choices starting in the 7th bar to get these sounds. So to finally sum this all up, from start to finish, we see the slash chord separated by half step a whopping 23 times, far and away the most. Next is the slash chord separated by whole step 16 times. These are two harmonies that you can easily associate with Zappa, so all in all, it really makes sense to me. One last thing to mention about the bass line that Zappa wrote, and tying into Brett's earlier point, is the symmetrical aspect. Notice how it and the melody starts and finishes on the very same notes, B flat over E. So even after all this wonderfully daunting harmonic information we've been fed, we still have to tackle the use of odd time signatures here. 6 is pretty self-explanatory. The fun part is the accents that Zappa puts. Beats 2, 4, and 6 of these bars. 1 and a, 2 and a, 1 and a, 2 and a. For the bar of 7, the bass provides all the rhythmic information you need to feel this correctly. 1 and 2 and 3 and a 1 and 2 and 3 and a 1 and 2 and 3 and a. The accents agree. The fun part of the next 6 16 bars is its accent choices. First is every other note, 1 and 2 and 3 and, until it switches the next bar. 1 and a, 2 and a. This continues for 10 bars in total, until this bar where we see accents just on the first and last notes. Up until this point, the bass has just been dotted quarters, but he switches to this 8th note quarter note rhythm. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2. It's like, just when the feel starts to get comfortable and obvious to the listener, he throws you off the scent. Especially with how locked in the bass and drums are on this figure, it's so much fun. For these last bars of 5 and 7, again, the bass tells you all you need to know. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. And lastly, there are some arrangement things here that we should talk about, and they actually make the harmonic planing element obsolete. Starting in 1980, Tommy Mars plays the odd time part strictly on Rhodes. Ed Mann plays the left hand part, or just the white keys, on Vibes in the 79 band. And just on Bells in the 81 band. The Rhodes-Bells combination was used to get a specific texture that Zappa called the Mr. Rogers texture. I'm a bit biased too, because that's my favorite Zappa band, but I love the way they play this interlude the best. The audience just goes nuts when any of the bands nail it. This section requires mastering a combination of precision, touch, and groove, and all three drummers hit on all those easily. I think it's worth taking a second to mention David Logerman and his playing on this tune, and the record in general, which is really very good. Like, obviously, yeah, it would have been cool to have more Vinnie stuff with Zappa, but for what he was asked to do, and on pretty short notice, Logerman does a tremendous job, and actually adds his own unique voice to this material. The drummer's personality and style probably have the most influence on the sound of the band, and this particular group has a lot of charm to it. Wow, so I certainly didn't expect to talk about this section of music, which is less than a minute long, for over an hour. Granted, I'm aware I dig into the details way too much, but still, I'm truly blown away by what's going on here. Not to get too mushy, but, you know, it's so interesting that in this silly song about a big-headed groupie, there's this wild interlude that sounds like complete chromatic madness. But underneath, there's these amazingly complex and lavish harmonies that you wouldn't even know existed unless you really stopped to take a look at it. He hides these undeniably gorgeous harmonies in a section that otherwise sounds completely chaotic, jarring, and harsh. Maybe a pretty good metaphor for his career as a whole.
As part of the enjoyment of analyzing Zappa's music, too, is finding these inventive and also very, very unusual ways of doing that, kind of taking things from more serious classical music and lightening them up, using them in original ways that nobody's really used them before, and very much like a magic trick, right? That's what he's interested in. He's trying to amaze you. He's trying to amaze us in a fun way. It's something that everyone can enjoy.
It really is all like a magic trick. And the crazy thing is, there isn't anything wildly advanced. He came up with this melody by playing the white keys with his left hand and the black keys with his right, and used isomelism, which is such a simple serial technique, and then harmonizes it with a plain old major triad. So I guess the first big takeaway is this. Zappa's music is obvious in his influences, and full of basic techniques, but he still finds his own unique identity within all of that.
Yeah, I think it's a good piece. I think it demonstrates in such a short spot, it demonstrates so much about that's interesting about Zappa, not only the stylistic changes and the way it's put inside this kind of silly song, but also just the composition by itself is really indicative of how Zappa was thinking in terms of his more atonal stuff, I think you get all of his little tricks in a small spot. His interest in all 12, using all 12 pitch classes, so kind of a broader aggregate completion. His interest in symmetry, but where he changes a note, so kind of incomplete symmetry, and also the isomelism thing. All those things tend to come up a lot in his music, so it's kind of interesting how a lot of times Zappa will have these pieces that have so much about him, all in a span of like 30 seconds or something.
And the last takeaway that I can't stress enough. We've done a lot of thinking. It's fair to say this music really hits the brain, but Zappa's music is about think and feel. Just listen to the drummers that have played this interlude and notice how hard it grooves despite being so difficult to play. I know it seems laughable to stress this point, especially if you listen to the interlude at tempo again, but I mean it. And just look at those stunning harmonies he slips in there. To me, I can't understand Zappa's music as anything other than the partnership between these two notions. Thanks for watching. I'd really like to thank Brett Clement for appearing in my silly video. This was an unbelievable pleasure for me, as someone who read his work while in music school and was so inspired by it. Please check out all of his writing. And thanks to Chris for suggesting this interlude. Please suggest any other ones in the comments that you'd like to see a breakdown of next. See you next time.